You don't have to do something and pray for hours and hours and hours before you get an unction. No, you've got the unction to function now. That's why I pray, and that's why the heavens are open. Come on. And so here, Jesus is in the wilderness. The devil doesn't mess with him for 40 days. He doesn't mess with him until he's good and hungry, where his flesh is at its weakest. Come on now. Where I am weak, he is. Oh, the devil is an idiot. Because he comes at you when you're at your weakest. He comes at you when you're down and the most down and out. And you don't even understand it sometimes because of what you've been beholding. But I'm going to challenge you. Behold that where you're weak, he's strong. And he's there for you. It's not just a theory that he's strong. He's strong in your behalf. And so here now, the enemy comes and says, if thou be the Son of God. Now why would he have said, if thou be the Son? Who told him he's the Son of God? A few verses ahead, the heavens opened, and the Lord said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Now we see it wasn't said for Jesus. It wasn't said to John. But I believe the enemy was there listening too. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. That's why the devil came and said, been sitting on this 40 days, I'm kind of ticked. Because I know the Lord's voice. I was around. I know this voice. So if you be the Son of God, then I know some things about heaven. I know some things about you. If you be the Son of God, then command that these stones be made bread, because I know you've got to be hungry about now. Do you see what's going on? The very thing that he tempted Eve with in the garden was food. Now he's trying to tempt the same Adam. Except he ain't the second Adam, he's the last Adam. Because that means he ain't coming around again. This is getting done right the first time, or the second time, the last time. And so Adam, where he failed in eating the fruit, the food, here he's trying to get Jesus to now, as an Adam, come on, a Son of God, to fail the same way with food. But what did he say? There's an important preposition that starts this whole chapter out, or this whole sentence out. It's if. Two letters. I-F. If. If you be the Son of God. Why? What does that matter? Well, number one, who told him he was the Son of God if he wasn't there listening and following Jesus? He must have already known he was the Son of God, or he wouldn't have been following him. Ooh, look at your neighbor and say, I don't care. I'm going to think it's good anyway. Yeah, listen. If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. That part about bread and stones and miracles is irrelevant. What's relevant is what he starts this sentence off with. If. If denotes doubt. If denotes a question about who you are. He knew who he was, or he wouldn't be messing with him. He knew that this was the Son of God. He had confirmation from his Lord. So who did he have to get to doubt? The same way he got Adam and Eve to doubt is the same way he thinks he's going to get Jesus to doubt. If you be the Son of God. Who told you you were the Son of God? As a matter of fact, if you are the Son of God, then why don't you perform this miracle and turn this bread or these stones into bread? He's trying to get him to perform out of insecurity. I know it ain't Thanksgiving yet, but I'm going to serve it up. If thou be the Son of God, O Eve, come on, first instance of that evil spirit I call window shopping. Over there, looking around at a tree that the Lord said to stay away from. All the other trees you can look at, don't go near that one. You know how much they had? All these trees, they ain't go to this one. It's just that human nature. Somebody might say, well, that's that unborn again nature. It's funny. Adam and Eve seem to be going just fine. It's a choice. It's what you behold. I want to have what they say I can't have. They go over to the tree. They come up. Now, this has always messed with me, Pastor Hill. Why is it that a serpent speaking from a tree was okay. One of two thoughts. The deception was so bad that it was okay for a snake to talk. Or, I can't prove it, you can't disprove it, there was communication with animals. Something did not spook her. He comes along, he's like... What's that noise? Eve, dumb white woman. Just come on, that's what I don't know. I don't care. Comes up, and the snake starts talking to her and says, hey, won't you take some of this fruit? Oh, no. Nah. I'm just looking. Window shopper. I'm just looking. Well, now, wait a minute. Why don't you eat some of this? No, I can't. God himself told us not to. Who said you couldn't? Who said you couldn't eat of this tree? Follow me. Eve says, God, but God didn't tell her. Adam did. The moment you come out from underneath the covering of your husband, it's going to be okay that a snake talks and you listen. The only snake you should be listening to is your husband. You hear me now? I got to set it. You got to write that down. Anyway, I'm just messing. Don't you know that the moment you eat of this fruit, you will be like God himself? Because of what she was beholding, Pastor. She didn't even realize she was already like God. If you be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Now follow me. He knew that Jesus was Jesus. He wanted to see if Jesus knew he was Jesus. If thou be the Son of God, if you're really called, if you're really called to ministry, how come this? If you're really a woman of God, how come that? If you're really a man of God, how come that? How come this? How come that? And the enemy will be there the entire time with his ifs and his don'ts and his what's and his all this to get you to doubt, to understand who you are, and then to prove to him who you are out of your insecurity of not knowing who you are. What would have happened if he would have commanded those stones, which he could have? We all agree he could have. What would have happened if he would have turned those rocks into bread? Look what Jesus says here. Are you still with me this evening? He said that it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Other translations say the mouth of my Father. In verse 4, we see the reason why if he had turned those stones into bread, what would have happened? He would have instantly obeyed Satan, and his fathers would have changed. Come on now, if thou be the Son of God, then do this. Let me translate. Since you are the Son of God, I need you to doubt who you are and then prove to me who you are so that I can subtly become your father like I did Adam and Eve. Oh, glory to God. Somebody ought to stop running. I'm not done. Sit down. Now, in verse 5, then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple. Now, why would he have done that? Why did he even know where these places are? You'd be shocked at how much the devil goes to church. How does he know this? Jesus brought up holy stuff. He's going to try and get him to be beat in his own arena. The devil, oh, he's such a liar. There's no truth in him. The Lord said this to me one time in prayer. He said, son, humility or our pride is thinking that you can whip the devil in his arena. Yeah. Humility is knowing he cannot beat you in yours. Stop coming out of your arena to try and whip him in his to prove who you are. Come on. Don't come out of the kingdom into that darkness. Stay in the light that you've been translated to. There's a reason you're there. Stay in that light. Hallelujah. Do not go into that arena. He's sucking you in. That's why the Lord said, stay away from that tree. Let me say it this way. Stay in your arena. Don't go in that one. All right. And so he took him up to the holy city, put him on top of the pinnacle. And it's amazing here is he says this, cast yourself down. And he started to misquote Psalm 91. He took it out of context. He's got him up on top of the highest pinnacle in the holy city, on the temple. And he says, cast yourself down and your angels will take charge and bear you up lest you dash your foot against the stone. Isn't that what the word says? Absolutely. But he misquoted it. He took it out of context because even Jesus knew this. He said, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. I want you to get a hold of this. The enemy takes Jesus to the highest pinnacle, the top of that city, on the temple, and says, look down, jump off, your angels will bear you up. Why did he tell him to jump? Anybody? One of the main reasons he told him to jump was because he wanted to kill him. But isn't it funny? He told him to jump. Because if he did anything else, he would have then had the power to push him. But apparently, he only had the power to get hold of this. Take him to the top of the edge and say, look down. Jump. Because he cannot push you off. He can take you to the place to where you think you can't handle anymore. He can take you to the place where you're at the edge of insanity. He can take you to the place to where you've never been before and you can't handle it. You can't take it. And then he says, you know what? Since I can't push you, why don't you jump? This is what the spirit of suicide is. Stop thinking you're an open target to the devil. You're not.
Come on now.
Start putting the tiger or the target on his behind. He needs to be walking around going, I'm in the wrong place. I didn't have a target until I got here. How do you know? Somebody said back here there's a target on. I just need to get out of here because that Christian's praying again. Oh, but brother, don't you know? I got to be concerned now. We've got to be. Use wisdom. Look, at human carnality, I never call wisdom. But you understand how people are. I got to use wisdom. You know what they say? New level, new devil. Oh, I don't know. I had a hard time at this level. I'm starting to get it. Got it under grasp. I can handle this. But I don't want to graduate to the next level. Although the Word says we go from glory to glory, faith to faith. We're continuing to move. We're continuing to progress. I like what Smith Wigglesworth says. He goes, if we're not progressing, we're digressing. Every morning I wake up, if I'm not further along with Jesus, then I'm backslidden. That's what he says every morning. Now, of course, not anymore because he's pretty far with Jesus. He's in heaven. Now, why do we always want to give the devil more power than he needs? Why do we want to give the devil more power than he actually has? Brother, new level, new devil. Have you ever heard that? Are you ready for this? You've got so much authority that if there's a new devil at a new level, he should be shaking in his boots and his horns should be about rattling off of his head. That instead of going new level, new devil, and all right, good, you're strong enough now. Ooh, you're moving up. You went from featherweight to bantamweight. Now you're moving up. Oh, now you're middleweight. Oh, okay, come on. We're looking for the heavyweights. I'm getting so good in my Christian walk. You're just getting beat up from one level to the next. That ain't how it works. You have all authority given unto you in all of heaven and in earth. You've got the power over the enemy on your weakest day. You are stronger than him on his best day. Oh, what would happen if this? The enemy went to the devil. I mean, one of the little demon imps went to the devil and he said, listen, you remember Sister Marilyn? Yeah, you remember my cousin had been attacking her on that last level. Well, somehow she's graduated, and I saw how she graduated. And I'm telling you right now, I don't want her as my assignment. Can I have somebody else, please? Maybe a good Methodist somebody, please. Just, I want somebody else. She is on fire. She is a crackerjack, fire, booming Christian. She's got power, authority. She's got more power in her pinky than I even know what to do with. Please, please, please. Instead of Christians going around saying all the time, the devil's been attacking me. Oh, the devil's just been on my case. He's chasing me. He's attacking me. The devil needs to go and say, I need somebody else. This Christian will not stop attacking me. The prayers need to keep messing with me. That fire is so great, I just can't handle it. You're not hearing me. That's all right. So the reason why he told Jesus to jump is because he couldn't push him off. Again, he said, if you be the Son of God, continuing to see if he would change allegiance and obey the devil instead of his father. Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. I love this. When you get this revelation, when you realize that the greater one is really on the inside of you, your life will never be the same. Get a hold of this. When the enemy comes and he's trying to attack you, you, again, on your weakest day, are stronger than the enemy on his best day. Don't miss this. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. So when the devil comes and he starts attacking you, and his assignment is to attack you, get a hold of this. You can stand there with assurance. You don't have to jump. You don't have to do anything. You just take your authority, having done all the stand there for, come on, knowing that he isn't tempting you, he's tempting your father. Do you believe that you can get so saturated with God that when you walk out of your closet that the enemy cannot tell if you're still in there or if God just walked out? Do you believe you can be so saturated with the Word of God, beholding the Word of God, that when you speak it under the anointing of the Lord, that the devil can't tell if it's you or if it's God? Can you get so soaked with the presence and power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God that when you speak, I've had God tell me this. He said, son, my words in your mouth are just as powerful as my words in my mouth. Come on. My words in your mouth, God speaking, is just as powerful with God's word in his mouth. So I can say to that mountain, be removed. It starts uprooting the moment it hears me address it. Have you ever wondered that about Mark 11:23? If anyone shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, doesn't doubt in his heart, but believe that those things that he says shall come to pass, he will have whatsoever he thinks, says. Have you ever wondered why he used the word mountain? Besides it being the largest known mass in all of the earth, besides my hand. Sorry. That woman's got her own zip code. I mean, she carries some real estate. She's got to pay taxes twice. You don't know nothing about that, but that's all right. But here's what happens now. He said that is because he knew that mountains had to obey him because the mountains were always hearing him pray. We keep praying that mountains be removed. Stop praying. We got to know when to say and when to pray. Jesus went up into the mountain apart and prayed so that he could have authority when he came down and with what he said, he had power. Well, I'm seeing a lot of lights going on. I hope it's that and it's not just the antihistamine kicking in. I'm like, come on now, are you with me? Are you here? Come on, stop looking at me like the deer in the headlights. I mean, you're looking at me like I am the deer in the headlights. Do you understand? Why do I have authority over everything? Because God gave it to me. The main thing that we don't have authority over is each other. We were not ever meant to rule and reign over each other. You don't see that in the Word. You see there's coverings. But you see, there's wills. There's shepherds you submit to. But then you have a will. If you don't want to be under that covering, that's your choice. But it's a whole lot better under a covering. Wives, you can be under the covering of your husband. But there's a whole lot better covering when the husband is the covering. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm going to ask you ladies to now give him his pants back. All right, now. I know this ain't a marriage seminar, but it would have been funny had it been a marriage seminar. That took you out of left field. You're like, yeah, woman, give me my pants back. Don't skirt around it. Give me my pants back. All right, good. All right, now, closing with this. Do you see that the heavens were already open to Jesus, and yet the funny thing is, that's when all the spiritual and all the crazy supernatural stuff began. And I'm going to say it this way. Although the devil came, you never see one instance where Jesus was afraid. As a matter of fact, I'll go a little bit further. Jesus was not afraid to the point that Satan was afraid, trying to get him to doubt who he was and jump off and kill himself because he couldn't push him. Oh, but when we see this, it goes a little further, and we're almost done. Again, the devil took him up into an exceeding high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them and said unto him, all these things will I give you if you will just fall down and worship me. Pastor Hill, we see what the enemy now wanted. The enemy didn't want fresh bread. The enemy didn't want him hang gliding and jumping to his death only. He wanted his worship. Oh, Christians, hear me. You don't have to have a black robe, red candles, and chant weird things to be a devil worshiper. Just obeying his little promptings because you doubt who you are in Christ. That alone can turn you in to a worshiper of the enemy. But I got good news for you. What you behold and what you're seeing tonight, and what you see that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. You are a conqueror right now, more than a conqueror. What does that mean? That means there's not a battle you cannot win. Brother, it's not my battle, it's the Lord's. That's fine, where is he? He's in you. That's why I told Jehoshaphat to go down and meet him. Oh, all right. Wow, glory to God. But then we go on and he says, he took him up into the high mountain apart. He said, fall down and worship me. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. Notice what he always said. It is written. What is he saying? Is what he's been beholding. He's been beholding his face as in a glass. The glory of the Lord or the Word of God. You want to have the glory manifest? Get in this Word. You want to see the glory in operation? Get in this Word. You want to see things change all around you? Get in this Word. And then get it into you. Behold in this Word. And you can change into the same image. Jesus said, it is written. Again. Get thee hence, for it is written. Thou shalt worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Well, praise the Lord. I believe this. I believe angels not just came and restored his physical body. I believe they also probably brought him food to help restore his physical body. Come on now. I believe there's a little bit of a parallel there between the ravens and angels. Angels are better, of course, amen? Because the ravens are from Baltimore. But, golly, did you go home already? I didn't promise it would be good, but I promised you'd have to think a little bit. Baltimore, ravens? But the thing is here, he wanted his worship. He wanted him to have him as his son. Adam became his son. How do you know? Because of all of mankind. That's why Jesus had to come. Jesus wasn't the second Adam. He was the last Adam to undo and outdo all that Adam had done. And when we see what he has done here, is that when he left the wilderness, he was led up by the Spirit, but left in the power. Now Jesus is able to do what John saw prophetically about his cousin, where he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with power. Glory, 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 glory. Fresh fire is coming on us tonight. Why? Because the windows of heaven are open. They don't shut, by the way. They're open. I want you to leave here with just a few nuggets. You're going to behold differently than what you've been beholding. If you've been beholding greatly, behold greater. Because God has never had a vision of us failing, and He's not going to start now. Guess who has the vision of us failing? I'm telling you, this revelation has been going off on the inside of me this year. The only one that's had a vision of me failing is the devil, trying to get me to doubt if you're really called of God, if you're really one of the sons of God, if you're really one of the daughters of God, then do this, do that, and do that. Or if you really are, then how come this happened, and how come that happened? Or how come you lost this person, and how come you lost that person? How come you didn't have this happen, and how come this, but, oh, just stop it, devil. And I'll tell you this, He will not stop it until you stop it. He can take you to the top. He can starve you and keep things from you for a season. But if you refuse to cowtail and fall down and worship Him or jump at every little whim and prove and try to perform every time He says, do this, do that, when you start saying, you know what, I know who I am in Christ. I already know who I am. I'm already seated with Him in heavenly places. If I'm seated with Him in heavenly places, then I can take my stand here on this earth. The only reason you're messing with me with visions of failure is because my God, who I behold, doesn't have those visions. The only reason you're trying to get me to have doubt and unbelief is because my God doesn't have doubt and unbelief. And you know I am a child of God. And if I'm a child of God, then doubt and unbelief is not going to rule and reign me. Fear is not going to overtake me. Visions of failure are not going to overtake me. But the devil will come and say, really? What about this? What about that? If you're called to do this, if you're really that, then you've got a vision of failure put in front of you. And he wants you to do what? To begin to meditate so you'll speak. Oh, you're not going to like this, but I'll still group hug you anyway. Most of us are not moving mountains. We're creating them.
Come on. That's true.
Do you know the devil is not a creative force? He is a created being. Did you know that we are created beings? But we're born again with creative power. That's why the devil can't stand you. That's why he can't stand the person that comes up and sings from their heart but can't sing a lick. Simon Cowell would kick him off of every show he's got. I'm sorry, this is just rubbish. But see, God doesn't look at that. The enemy does. Because don't you know I was built with pipes on the inside of me? Don't you know I am worship? Don't you know that you've got my job now and it ticks me off? Don't you know you couldn't do it? You don't sound nearly as good as I do. When you're trying to sing in the shower, I sing in heaven. Yeah, where are you at now? Where are you at now? God has perfected my praise so much that it comes out sounding like two vultures fighting in a garbage truck. But by the time it gets to Him, it's perfect. My joyful noise may be noise to you, but when it gets to Him, it's worship to Him. Let's lift our hands. The power of God is in this house tonight. There is a presence of the Holy Ghost that is in this place that I haven't felt in some churches. Oh my goodness, Lord, I thank You and praise You for Your presence. Thank You and praise You for Your goodness. Your mercy endures forever. Oh, just begin to pray in the Spirit right now together.